Y'all sound great. Come on, let's sing another one.
The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the one for me. I said I love the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the one for me. I said I love the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. Bible.
Let's get our marching shoes out for this one.
Yeah. that, Lord, you would help us to remember that we were designed for your glory, so that your glory can be known and can be praised. So we sing. All of us in his image. He created you special.
Lord, you have warned me and you know me.
He is our creator, so he knows every single thing about you.
Without you, Lord,
he knows your thoughts before you think them.
Excited to get to answer that question. What is God's favorite song? And it's right here inside of this song. We're gonna sing you the answer.
He loves to hear the wind sing as it whistles through the pines on mountain peaks. And he loves to hear the raindrops as they splash to the ground in a magic melody. And he smiles in sweet approval as the waves crash to the rocks in a harmony. And all creation joins in unity to sing to him majestic symphonies. But his favorite song of all is the song of the redeemed, when lost sinners now may hear, lift their voices loud and strong, when those purchased by his blood lift to him a song of love, nothing more in heaven here, so pleasing. They sing, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Heaven's choir in harmonies lift up praises to the great I am.
Alleluia, alleluia.
But he lifts his hands for silence when the weak is saved by grace. Soul sings, I have been redeemed. That's his favorite song of all.
It's the song of the redeemed.
With lost sinners now in pain, their voices loud and strong. With those purchased by his blood.
In the presence of Jesus Christ and sing that song. How about you?
Yeah!
Ah, that's amazing. That's amazing. Well, my name is Debbie, and I'm privileged to be here because we just want to share a little bit with you about what goes on in our family ministries, the creativity that our team uses to present the Bible stories to kids. And so we are so, wait a minute. No, Rachel, he was a cop. Security, are you doing your job?
Shakespearean style, one man, Bible story reenactor, and part-time fry cook at Gus's Tater Shack. So, come back to me.
Reginald.
Hello!
what are you doing here?
Yeah, well, we really need security.
I know, that's what I was wondering.
I don't know.
Where are
I shouldn't
they?
Even yes. be out here, but I'm here. No, yes. I heard you were going to tell the story like we do in Kids World, so I'm here to bring the story to life.
Reginald, we already have a story planned. We have some really exciting, amazing things that are going to happen. And
you have a plan, but I have a better plan.
No,
yes, in all of our family ministry environments, we are telling the story of creation.
Yes.
So I shall bring the story of creation to life. I call my script, "It Was the Best of Times. It Was the Beginning of Time." So you shall read it, okay? Actually, I don't even need you to read it. Just hold it up, and I will bring the story to life. Okay, begin.
In the beginning. I'm telling you,
in the beginning, there was nothing. And then God said, "Let there be light." Oh, look at me. I am light. I'm the fastest thing in the universe. Actually, I'm quite a bit lighter. It's the Pilates. So, thank you.
Well, that's,
yes. And then that was, hold up the thing. That was day one. Yes. Okay. And then God said, "Let the waters be separated." There you go.
Wait a minute. We don't need.
And the sky was born. And that was day two. It was
day two.
And then day three, God said, "Plant." And then on day four, God said, "Let the sun and the moon appear." Yes. And then, hold this for me.
Okay, what?
He created.
What do you want to do with this thing?
The stars.
Right you there. Would make yourself the star.
I'm the star.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, Reginald, really, I think that's enough.
But I have so many more days.
We don't have a lot of time, and we have something
day
really
six?
Special.
Yeah. I was going to dramatically nap for day seven.
Well, why don't you go and do that right now?
What?
Yes, I think it's time for you to go ahead.
I see.
Take
yes.
your nap.
I'm an actor, but I can pick up on signals when I'm not wanted or
okay.
needed.
Reginald, now that's not what I meant. You are definitely needed.
It's fine.
But we have a story planned already, and you know,
okay.
here's what I was thinking. In just a few months, we're going to be talking about patience.
Everyone says I'm so good at teaching patience.
You definitely are good at teaching patience.
Yes.
So, yeah,
I shall exude stage left thusly. Farewell. Thank you.
So long, Reginald.
Left my cloud.
Don't forget
okay.
your cloud.
Goodbye. Yes, thank you.
Well, yes, Reginald does like to visit Kids World for sure, but today we have something really special for you. So let's go ahead and get started. In the beginning, there was nothing. Nothing except God. And then God began to create. He created the heavens and the earth. At first, the earth was not like it is today. It didn't have any shape and it was empty. Everything was dark. Deep water was everywhere and there was no life at all. But then God said, "Let there be light." And suddenly light appeared. Bright light. Before there was nothing, now a new, brilliant, and magnificent light. God separated the light from the darkness. He called the light day and the darkness he called night. And that was the very first day. Then God separated the waters to form a huge space. God called the huge space sky, and that was day two. And then on the third day, God made the waters under the sky flow together. The waters created waves and currents. They formed into oceans and vast expanses of deep and wide waters, an entire world unto themselves. As the waters gathered, dry land appeared. Dry ground with rich and soft soil. Hard rock that would tower into mountains and plateaus, sand that formed beaches and rolling expansive dunes. God saw that it was good. Then God continued to create. He made the land sprout with plants. Trees, bushes, vegetables, and fruits of all kinds grew in abundance across the earth, from the tiniest rose petal to the towering and majestic pine forests. God created each one, each plant with its own hue and shade, its own smell and touch, each one uniquely its own, and each one with its own purpose. God looked upon his creation and saw that it was good. And that was day three. On the fourth day, God placed lights in the sky to separate the night from the day. He made them signs to mark the seasons, days, and years. God made two great lights, a larger one, the sun, to shine in the day, and a smaller one, the moon, to shine at night. But God wasn't done creating. God breathed into the universe every type of star and constellation. They glimmer and shine brightly in the dark night sky. And God, in the vastness and expanse of space, knows each star by name. Looking upon the canvas of the universe, God saw that it was good. And that was day four. On the fifth day, God created all the creatures in the water and of the air. The ocean swarmed with every unique kind of fish and sea creature, from the small pygmy seahorse to the giant blue whale. The expansive oceans that God had created teemed with life. Worlds unto themselves, they filled the wondrous, amazing fish, and each one created with the purpose by their creator. Then God created all the birds. There were hawks and eagles, doves and sparrows, each one unique in its feathers and songs, some with majestic and proud crows and others with sweet, soft songs. God saw that it was good. Then God blessed them and told them to have babies and to fill the waters and the sky. And that was day five. On the sixth day, God created all kinds of living creatures. He made the livestock from the humble cow to the proud horse. God imagined them and then crafted them, pigs, oxen, and sheep, each one unique. And he created the small animals that scurry along the ground, lizards, mice, insects of every kind, groundhogs, and countless others. God created the wild animals, the mammoth and majestic elephant, the crafty and swift fox, and the playful monkey. He even created the proud and powerful lion. God created animals of all shapes, sizes, and colors. He created creatures that defy our imaginations in their grandeur and power. He created those that are no longer even in existence, those that no living human has ever even seen. God created it and said that it was good. But God was not done. Though the creation before him was incredible, breathtaking in its vastness and size, hard to comprehend, he saved his final creation for day six. For his most prized and valuable creation, God created you. On day six, God created the first human beings. And even before the world had yet fully begun, God knew that one day he would create you, that one day he would knit you together inside of your mother and would create each one of you in your own unique and wonderful way. Before your heart was beating, God knew your name and the hairs that would be on your head. He knew where you would be born and how long you will live. He knew the color of your eyes and the sound of your voice. He knew each and every fact that makes you uniquely you. Because we, human beings, were to be his most prized creation, prized more and loved more by our Creator than we could possibly imagine. So on day six, God said, "Let us make mankind in our own likeness." The man Adam, he shaped from the dust and breathed life into his nostrils. And from the man, he made woman. He made the human beings in his own likeness, in his own image. God put part of his image inside of you. God, each one of us is a veiled and incomplete reflection of our heavenly Creator. He gave the first humans the ability to be able to think and reason. He made them with emotions. He told them to have children and to fill the whole earth with people. Then God looked over all he had created, and he saw that it was very good. And that was the sixth day. That completed God's creation of the heavens and the earth. And on the seventh day, God rested from all his work. And he blessed the seventh day and made it holy. Creation. God made the world and everything in it. You are meant for something. You were created with a purpose by a creator who loves you more than you could ever imagine. A creator who, when sin and imperfection threatened to tear him away from his creation, became man. His son came to earth as Jesus Christ to live a perfect life we never could, to pay for all the wrong we've ever done on a Roman cross, so that we could be reunited with our creator, so that we could be part of his story. From the very beginning, the Creator had you in mind, a reflection of his image to a world who so desperately needs to know their Creator and his plan for their salvation. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your creation. Thank you that you've created each and every person who's hearing my voice with a unique design, a purpose to live out for you. Father, I pray that each person will understand that person, that purpose, and will live it out to their fullest, Father, in the days that you've given them on this earth. Thank you for all you've done, and thank you for all you're going to do. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I see your face in every sunrise. The colors of the morning are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. I look up to the sky and say, you're
team. Have you enjoyed the music today and all the hard work that this team goes through? They're actually preaching the message today. We have a lot more music than we usually do, but I asked them if they would help me preach the message. And so Austin and the team, thank you so much for what you guys do. Well, in 2006, I'll celebrate 30 years on staff here at New Spring October 1st. Yeah, well, I appreciate that. But in 2006, Mark came to Debbie and I and asked if we would oversee family ministry. And after praying, you know, about it, we knew God was calling us to it. And now it's been 18 years. And so we've been in it long enough that we have kids that were fifth and sixth and seventh graders when we started. And now they're married and they're bringing their kids to New Spring and got a chance to marry a few of those kids. And we have just enjoyed being part of family ministry here at New Spring. When Mark asked me, Debbie and I, as we were praying about it, we were saying to ourselves, what is going to be the most important things we want our kids and children and our own grandchildren to know? And what are we going to make the pillars of this ministry? And that's what I want to talk to you today about, is just how we feel about family ministry here at New Spring. First of all, you saw it in Miss Debbie's story. By the way, that was my wife that did the creation story, if you don't connect us together. I'm a little worried because she always says Debbie. She doesn't say Debbie Kubish, but I claim her, okay? She's all mine, 39 years, and I love her to death. But you know, about the creation story we're talking about all month in all our environments. We try to talk about creation twice a year because it's so important. And so the first thing that we believed and we still believe is that children are made in the image of God. In Genesis 1:27, you heard Debbie talk about it. God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. What we believe is that when kids believe that they are made in the image of God, it will impact how they make decisions and how they find purpose in their life. Children are a blessing from God. Psalms 127 says, children are a gift from the Lord. They are a reward from him. And sometimes, you know, I'm concerned whether we really still believe that children are a blessing from the Lord, that he is a rewarder to those of us that have kids. Because sometimes we don't pay attention to our kids as much as we should. You know, when kids say, hey, dad doesn't really want to hang out with me because he wants to play his video games, or mom is too busy to read a book to me because she's on Facebook all the time. But if we treat our kids like they're a blessing and reward from God, we'd probably treat them a little bit differently. They want to be noticed. Some of us focus what's wrong with the kids of today. Instead, we need to see them how God sees them. In the book of Mark, if you want to know what Jesus did in his earthly ministry, read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those are the Gospels, and it'll tell you about what Jesus did when he was on the earth. And in Mark, Jesus is out ministering to the people, and a group of parents got together and say, hey, let's go. Jesus is teaching today. Let's go and take our kids down to Jesus and let Jesus bless them. And so they get down there, and all of a sudden the disciples see someone trying to approach Jesus because he's talking to adults evidently, and they tell him to stop. And they scolded the parents for bringing their kids to Jesus. And according to God's word, Jesus got angry at the disciples and said, let the children come, because the kingdom of heaven is just like these kids. You got to have a childlike faith to enter into the kingdom. And so one of my favorite verses that I read probably, it seemed like 1,000 times when we were about ready to take over kids ministry, it's verse 16. And it says, then he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on their heads, and blessed them. Jesus has time for kids. Aren't you glad for that? And he has time for you, by the way. Every child needs someone who doesn't see them as an interruption, but as a divine appointment. Children need to be able to own their own faith. That's the third one. Children need to be able to own their faith. Now, didn't you love singing those old songs at the beginning? I saw some of you doing the motions. I may never fly over the enemy. I love those songs. But I even noticed some of you were tearing up because it brought back memories when an adult was investing in you and in your life and those songs that you used to sing. There was a song that didn't make the cut. I asked Austin and Carl if they could come up with that arrangement for me for family ministry, and one of the songs we didn't put in there is The Wise Man. Remember that? The wise man built his house upon the rock. The rain came down, you know, all that stuff. Well, Jesus said in Luke chapter 6, verse 47, I will show you what it's like when someone comes to me, Jesus, and listens to my teaching and follows it. It's like a person building a house who digs deep and lays the foundation on solid rock. And when the floodwaters rise and break against the house, it will stand firm because it's well built. We in kids ministry and family ministry want kids to have a firm foundation in God's word. Yes, we want to have fun here, and we think it's all right to have fun at church. We say we put the pill of learning in the pudding of fun, and we don't apologize for that. We want kids to come to church and have fun, because our competition is not the church down the street. The competition is all the amusement parks, Chuck E. Cheese, and everything else. So we want to make an environment for kids to come in and learn God's word, but it's more than just listen. We want these kids to follow Jesus. We want the kids to know where to find scripture in the Bible. Where is the New Testament, the Old Testament, the 66 books? How do you lead someone to Christ? How do you pray? We want them to have a firm foundation, because as they get older and they get in high school and college and they're challenged about their faith, that they'll have a firm foundation in God's word. Because the church should be the best place to find hope. It really should be the best place to find hope. This letter was put on my desk a couple weeks ago. It's from Bailey. She's in our fourth and fifth grade environment, Studio 45. And she had started a little business. They did kind of entrepreneurial thing in their school. And she was selling frozen, you know, slushes and stuff like that. And it says this, and she sent an offering in the mail to us. My name is Bailey, and I started a business called SB Tropical. I decided to donate 20% to New Spring. You know, the tithe is 10%, but she thought she better do 20. What we can learn from our kids, huh? But I wanted to give you 20% because what you have been a tremendous impact on me in my life. You have showed me who God is and showed me how to have a relationship with Him. Without New Spring, I would not know as much as I know about the Bible. New Spring has helped me to see others before myself, like Project Generosity and the Big Ideas and much more. Thank you for all you do, not just for me, but for a whole lot of people. Love, Bailey. Yeah. Bailey is owning her own faith. She is owning her own faith, and we want that for every child here. According to the International Bible Society, 83% of people that come to faith are between the ages of 4 and 14. And that's why family ministry is so important. We have to reach them while they're young. And so how do we instill that hope and invest in the next generation? Debbie and I, we have two things that we, there's many things, but we have, you know, for time, we're just gonna narrow it down to two. One is relationships. A child needs a relationship with their parents and grandparents, a relationship with those who lead them, a relationship with a caring volunteer. They need to feel loved and cared for. What will keep kids and families coming back to New Spring? Relationships. Does this mean we pull back from all the fun lessons and crazy games and dynamic things that we do and having fun? No, it's just part of our strategy. All these things are great because they help build and strengthen relationships with kids. Kids will continue to come back to New Spring because a dedicated volunteer cares about them and will ask them how their week went. What they need from us is to give them opportunities to build relationships. That's why small groups are such a big deal around here, not only for kids, because even in Adventure Avenue Preschool, we have small groups for kids. They have the same leader at every service. And so it's a big deal there, but also throughout our whole family ministry, but also for you adults. Daniel Mahana leads our small groups, and if you're not in one, you should get in one. The other thing that kids need that we want to talk about is they need to be seen. They need to be recognized. They want to know that someone knows their name. They want to know they are missed when they're absent. They want to hear their name called in prayer. One of my favorite things to do when I go teach in any of the environments, if it allows me, some of the environments are a little bit different, but in 252 especially, after we get done with the little message for the kids, I love to go sit on the front of the stage as kids are being dismissed and parents are leaving this room and going to pick up your kids. And kids will just line up and want to tell you all the things they want you to pray about with them. And I've prayed for many a goldfish to make it, you know. I prayed for dads to get wise and buy their children a puppy. But there's some pretty important prayer requests that kids have. Can you pray for my mom? She doesn't get out of bed very much. She's very sad. She doesn't have a lot of hope. Can you pray for my mom and dad? They always argue. Can you pray for my dad? I won't see him for 5 or 10 years because he's in prison and I miss him. And even in the high school ministry, when I'm in there, I had a young man, probably it's a couple months now. He came to me after one of our lessons and he said, "Hey, Mr. Dan, can I just have you pray something for me?" I said, "Absolutely." He said, "I really feel like I'm called into the ministry, but my mom and dad really doesn't want me to do that. They want me to follow the money, and they know I won't make much money in ministry." Kids want to be in a place where adults will pray for them. Because the crazy thing is, for some reason, our mindset is there's a junior Holy Spirit that works in kids. When the kids become a Christian, they get the Holy Spirit just like you do. There's not a junior version of it. They get God's Holy Spirit inside their lives, and they want to do things for God. They want to go out and change the world around them, and they need someone to be on their side, cheering them on to say, "Follow God with your life. Follow God with your life." Recognition happens one child at a time. God uses willing volunteers to recognize the potential he has placed inside our children. They want high fives when they walk into the room. They want to know that you'll be there for the ups and downs in their lives as a volunteer. So why do we invest so much here at New Spring in family ministry? One, we invest in family ministry because we want to see our children and grandchildren grow in their faith and become disciples of Jesus for a lifetime. At the end of the day, that's what matters most. We want your children to experience the radical love of Jesus and what it means to walk with them daily. It's obvious that Jesus loves kids, and here at New Spring, we think kids are a pretty big deal, and the staff and volunteers have a passion to reach boys and girls for Jesus Christ. We've invested millions of dollars to impact the next generation and their spiritual growth. We invest in family ministry because we care about the future of the church and want to make a lasting impact. Your children and grandchildren will be the spiritual leaders here one day at New Spring, and we want to help them prepare for that. Long after we're gone, the children will carry on the work of the kingdom. We have the opportunity right now to walk alongside your child and let them learn from our experiences following Christ. We invest in family ministry because we want to partner with you, the parent, and help you maximize your influence to lead your children. It is hard sometimes to lead your child spiritually, and that's why we want to partner with you. You know, and one of the ways you can partner with us is when we have activities here at the church or events is to bring your child to them. One, you heard Artie talk about at the top of the hour. We have Kids World FX. It's this Friday night at 6:30 p.m. You can put it on your calendar. And it's where hundreds of families will come in these doors, grandparents, aunts and uncles, everybody. Invite every neighbor along your street. Anybody is welcome to come. Kids or no kids, you can still come. And we have a celebration. We have fun stories like you just saw up here with Reginald and Miss Debbie. We sing some great music. We play some silly games. You know, you don't want to miss this gigantic cannon we're going to bring out this Friday. It's amazing. And we're going to have just a spectacular time exploring God's big ideas. But then at the end of the night, the top thing we do is we're gonna watch 30 kids go public with their faith in baptism. Yeah. And these kids have done their testimonies. They have testified how they accepted Christ in their life, and they want to live for them, and they live for him, and they want to tell the world that they are a follower of Jesus Christ and are not ashamed to tell the world that they do that, they believe that. And so we want to partner with you with the spiritual influence of your kids. Right now, I have a video I want you to watch, and you're going to see some kids that are currently in Kids World and Family Ministry. You're going to see some volunteers that help us. You're also going to see some parents that have been blessed by sending their kids into family ministry, and some of them have also volunteered in the ministry. So look at the screens and watch this.
You know, it's awesome to see your kids want to come to church, and they get excited about it, and they're coming to church. We know that they're learning about Jesus and how much he loves them, but it's a great environment that, you know, kids look forward to coming to and being a part of. And it's not, oh, we have to go to church. It's, hey, we get to go to church. Yeah.
I love learning the Bible verse. It's called, be joyful because you belong to the Lord. I will say it again, be joyful.
My son accepted Jesus at concert at the park, and my daughter at Leading the Way. So if we didn't have New Spring in the community investing all this time and energy and resources into the things that they're doing, I don't really know where our family would be right now.
I started volunteering about 4 years ago. I just saw how much fun and involvement my wife was having. And so that was really cool to get to watch her connection with these kids and see how she was leading them. And I was like, man, I want that. I want to invest in the next generation.
The kids are very excited to invite their friends. So they come and they learn, and they'll try to find a friend that they can bring that's maybe never been to church before. And that's exciting for them because they get to walk into an environment that's for their age, you know, and that really reaches them at the age they're at.
I like to thank Mr. Cody because he just tells a story and he makes it have a lot of fun. And just instead of just having the story, we get to play games, we get to worship, and that's just awesome. I just love it.
We came from a small church, knew everybody. And so we came here and we're like, oh my gosh, this is a very large church. So we come in, people greeted us. We felt like we belonged. They showed us exactly where to go. We took the kids to their environments. You know, we want our kids to be fed the bread of life. That's why we're coming to church. So we were trying to figure out what they would actually learn. We get in the car and we were like, do you have fun today? Yeah, we had lots of fun. And we said, what did you learn? And Dash starts in, you know that story about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? And we were like, yeah. And Dharma's like, yeah, they went into a fiery furnace. And so they're telling us these Bible stories. And I'm like, oh my goodness, they know exactly what's going on. And we were really impressed with what the kids had learned. So we actually never went anywhere else. We stayed here.
Really, I've grown to see that by serving, it's impacted my faith. And even this year, going to Leading the Way and watching how they worship, I've lived through this season seeing how authentic worship really looks like, where that was not something that was a part of my life necessarily. Not that I didn't love to sing and I didn't love to worship, but just to see students going all out showed me, why am I not doing that in my faith? And why am I not showing that in my walk?
At Kids World, we have a lot of fun and also treat ours the way we want to be treated.
It's a lot easier to try new things when you have people who are encouraging you and who ask you, hey, do you want to come do a skit on stage, or do you want to come, you know, sing a worship song or something? It's a lot easier to try new things when you have so many people supporting you and teaching you and eager to help you learn.
The sooner you get involved, the more you buy into what Jesus is doing here at New Spring. You have to be involved. Sitting in services does not give you the blessings that God wants to pour on you when you just give a little bit of your time and energy.
My favorite memories is in 252 is looking back and seeing all the tech and them working the shows and everything and the production and all that stuff. So when I got old enough, I started asking, like, can I serve? Can I do this? So I started serving, and now I'm doing tech and audio, lights, switcher, all that sort of stuff. And I feel like this is God's calling to me.
What we get on Sundays at 9:15 when we go to the service is amazing, but what we get afterwards pouring back into the church, I mean, you can't replicate that anywhere. I mean, it just has deepen our relationship with Christ as well. Just serving, we're not meant to just consume, and so we need to go out and be part of the church.
Kids also taught me that I could be brave just like Jesus was, and that God was very nice and very loving to me.
Another thing I vividly remember was, it was COVID and church had been shut down for a little bit. They were doing porch visits. And I had seen that they were doing some porch visits, and I was like, oh, that would be fun. I get a call and a text from Becky and Amy who say, hey, we're doing porch visits. Can we come and see you? And I was like, we live 2 hours away. And they're like, we know. So they come all the way down. We didn't tell Dharma. And they show up and Dharma is screaming and runs out and meets them. And so they love, love, love your kids. The volunteers love your kids.
When you serve, your kids see you serve, and you guys sometimes get served together. And so it's just starting a generational opportunity for your kids to be able to, you know, serve people and serve the Lord at the same time. And just watching other kids light up and just being excited.
I wanted to volunteer because my dad used to work here. And ever since I was little and he was doing it, I wanted to be like him and do what he did. And so when I was in fifth grade, I started, and I've just been doing it ever since.
For the parent that is busy, I think we all are busy. I think you need to change the word busy to priority. If instead of saying I'm too busy, you need to say that's not a priority to me. And when you say that's not a priority to me, that hits a little differently. So for me to say it's not a priority for me to serve over these middle school girls, that hits a little different. And when you make that shift in your head, it becomes very easy to find the time to come in for an hour for the impact that you're making.
A lot of people think that you need like a skill set or need talent and something to serve, and that is so far from the truth, because, you know, when we serve, we're doing it for God, and that's our strength. God is our strength, not us. So when you have no skills, when you have nothing, that's great, because then you have to have God work through you, and that's when amazing things happen. So I think if you're scared of serving, if you think you don't have what it takes, then great. That's who we're looking for.
Getting to invest in the next generation it's literally everything. So to me, it's worth spending my weekend time volunteering and getting in a small group and getting involved. It's worth it. Just give it one chance, and it'll change your life. It's awesome.
You know, it truly takes a village to raise a kid, and having this village has been such a blessing for us.
I love going to this church, and I love helping others. I love to go to church too.
I couldn't ask for a better church, yeah. Better leaders.
I agree.
Two thumbs up for Kids World.
I'm so blessed, got this heartbeat in my chest, Lord, doesn't matter about the rest, if I got you, Lord, I'm so blessed.
And I think Beck and Amy, you're in the room, right? I saw you, you're right there, raise your hands up, raise your hand way up, drove all the way down to Independence, Kansas to check on a kid, and that is amazing. We love our small group leaders and how they invest. So how does all this happen? How do we invest in the next generation? How do we build relationships that matter? Making environments where kids want to grow spiritually and they want to be in. It takes people to care about the next generation and serve the Lord through the local church. When we serve, we begin to look more like Jesus. We really can't grow as a follower of Jesus until we follow Jesus in serving. Now, you know, serving empties our me-first tendencies. The act of service in the body of Christ is a demonstration of obedience, an exercise in faith, and a revolution against selfishness. There's a line that has been put in my sermon. I have taken it out and put it in probably 15 times. And I'm going to tell you what it is, but I want you to know it is with the passion of ministry and reaching boys and girls for Jesus Christ and students and to win the lost of South Central Kansas and around the world that I say this. For the church to be able to survive and to reach the next generation for Christ throughout the world and here at New Spring Church, the church has to be filled with laborers, not just consumers. We have to have people working in the harvest. We can't just come in and sit and listen to worship, get fed by Mark Hoover, and go out and not give it away and not serve the body of Christ. My dad had an expression, he called it sit, soak, and sour. You come in and sit, and you soak it all in, but then it never is released. It's all kept to you. Because see, God expects us to be rivers of blessings, not just reservoirs. When we find joy in serving others through our gifts, we are honoring, glorifying, and worshiping the God that created us. Some of us will use the excuse today, I'm too busy to invest in the next generation. But if we're really honest with ourselves, we'd just have to say, the Lord's work just doesn't make my priority list. We all have the same amount of time in the day, and it's how we prioritize our calendar. When was the last time you prayed over your calendar before you put something on it? I was talking to Billy Poor, our executive pastor. He's quite a thinker. He's one of the smartest guys I know. And he was in my office this week, and we were talking about this message. And in fact, I read that line that I read to you, and I said, I keep taking it out and putting it in. He said, well, Dan, you have to tell him the truth. But we're sitting there dreaming about all the things New Spring could do if we had more volunteers helping in the harvest. There's things that we'd like to do that we can't do because we do not have enough volunteers. And you might hear that, oh, we have 1,000 volunteers, but when you're a growing church, the need is always there. And you might be sitting there and saying, hey, maybe the church staff should just take care of this. Maybe, you know, that's what they're supposed to do. The church staff just take care of it. Well, this past week, if I just had my, because we have a large family ministry staff, if I just said, okay, family ministry staff, you're taking care of all of family ministry, there's no volunteers that are gonna help you. You are just gonna have to do it by yourself. Last week, we saw 2,000 kids come birth through high school. If we just had staff to do it, I would have to say no to 1,300 kids. Say no, you can't come to our church because we cannot take care of you the way we should. I don't want to do that, and I'm sure you don't want to do that either. But we are a vibrant ministry, and we depend on volunteers to step up and to be a part of God's work. We depend on it. We can't afford to have a budget that big to hire everybody. We depend on staff, dedicated staff and skilled volunteers to pull off what we do here at New Spring Church. And we have a saying that you saw in that video, and we've had it for years, and it hasn't been as prevalent as it has been in the past, but we're gonna start beating this drum again. And you saw some signs around the concourse and stuff, and it says, worship one, serve one. We want everybody to worship in a service. We want everybody to be in this room and hear the beautiful music and worship the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and to hear Mark Hoover and his unbelievable messages that he brings, which he starts a new series next week, so make sure you come back. We want everybody to be able to experience that. We really do. But this is our ask. We want everybody. If you are a believer and if you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and you call New Spring your home, we want everybody to say, I will give you another 70 minutes. I will give the Lord another 70 minutes after I leave this place and I get filled up and blessed. I'm gonna give the church 70 minutes and I'm gonna go serve the body of Christ. That's what we're asking. And if you say, Dan, you're kind of pushing. Yes, I am. I am, because I know what's at risk. We want the more people come to the Lord and be saved. We want to make heaven a little bit more crowded, and we have to have volunteers that help a staff to pull that off. There's no other way to do it. And so you can take out your phones, you can go home and pray about it, but once you get ready to do it, we want you to text say yes to 97,000. And when you text that, say yes to 97,000, it'll send you back in a form with all the ministries you can help in. And maybe God's not calling you into family ministry. Maybe he's calling you to be the best guest service person or help in the parking lot or drive a golf cart or maybe work in the coffee shop or do security. Or maybe you like to run on one of these cameras or sing in the worship choir, whatever it is, but we need you. But what we're asking is just to pick one. Some of you will have a big heart and you'll check every box on that page. And that makes it a little bit more difficult for us because then we have all these different ministry heads that are gonna have to call you. But if you just pick one. We want you to worship in a service and then serve in a service. What is the faith of the next generation worth to you? Well, before I close and we're out of time, you might be here for the first time, or maybe you've come back several times. And even in Debbie's story of creation, she talked about what God did for us. We were a broken people, and we can't get to heaven on our own, can we? Sin can't be in heaven because heaven is perfect, and we have an issue. The Bible says we've all sinned and fell short of God's standard to get to heaven. So what did God do? God loved us, didn't he? And God gave. He loved us so much that he gave his son Jesus to die on the cross to pay the penalty for your sin and my sin. And in that one great moment in history, Jesus paid for the price of everyone's sin debt, past, present, and future, when he died on that cross. They took him down and buried him, and 3 days later, he rose again. So now we have a Savior that not is only perfect, that saves us from our sins, but also he's conquered death. And if we just put our faith and believe that he did that for us and receive his free gift and just ask him, God, come into my life and change me, save me. I put my trust in you. According to his word, he'll do that. And you can walk out these doors knowing that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And when your eyes close in death on this earth, you will wake up in the glories of heaven, not based on anything Dan Kubish has said or Mark Hoover, but because the word of God says that he will make that happen for you. So, as we wrap up, I'd like for you just to bow your heads and close your eyes and don't mess with your neighbor. And just, if you're ready to receive Christ's free gift, you can just pray this prayer. These aren't magic words. You can use your own words, but just be sincere and honest with God. Dear God, I know that I'm a sinner and have done a lot of bad things, and I don't deserve what you are willing to give me, eternal life. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross and to pay the penalty for my sins. And right now, I put my faith and trust in what Jesus did. I believe Jesus died for me and paid the penalty for my sins. I believe that he was buried and 3 days later he rose again. And now he sits on the right hand of the Father. And I accept your free gift. I accept your free gift. Let me live for you. Let me tell others about what you did for me just now. Let me live for you. Thank you for saving me. Amen. Now, if you just prayed that, we are excited for you. Aren't we, New Spring? The angels, the favorite song of all is the song of what? The redeemed. And just think, the Bible talks about the angels in heaven rejoicing when someone comes to Christ. And I'm sure they're breaking out Diet Coke and chocolate brownies on the people that just accepted Christ into their life. But if you text PRAYED to 97,000, we'd love to give this gift box to you. There's a Bible in here, a devotional book, or you can just go by any of the guest service counters. They'll hand this to you at no charge. They love to celebrate with you. Thank you for being here. God bless you. Next week, we start a brand new series, Songs for the Anxious Mind. Mark will be here. God bless you. Say yes to 97,000. Say yes to 97,000. Thank you.